Maybe one day I will get all of that intro looking real cool. I'm just gonna get into this straight away. No horsing around. So, there's a few things I want to say first. Guys, first of all, Core Cat returns. Second, my trades are pretty good. Let's review round two before we get into what I've done so far. I gained like 1500 spots with what's his name missing? Josh Kelly missing. So basically I had McKenzie on field for 44. And yeah, it's very annoying. With that 44 on field, because as opposed to most people, I had the intention of having McKenzie on my bench, at least to start the year. Like I did, you saw it in the first round. I had him on bench. And the only reason he comes on field is to basically cover Bytel and Kelly coming out. And I guess I could have traded Kelly as well as Bytel and then had him off the field, but everyone has him on ground, so I think, well, it's like a, it's just every, it's not a loss or a gain. But yeah, some of my strategy was really good. It's just these injuries have just given me like to start the year a pullback, like a handicap. But I mean, again, I can't, I'm not gonna complain. Just yet, I am starting to get there in terms of feeling a little hard done by, especially with my captain looking like that. Thank you, Luke Beveridge. Oh boy, get into that in a second. But yeah, to just increase in rank to 1500 spots with Kelly on my bench, it's basically, it's basically a good thing in my opinion. Like I'm not trading these keepers that a lot of other people are sideways trading to. Like most people that had Kelly went to Green, and it's looking like not the right option with his 90 there. It's just, it's what I, like I said last week, it's what I thought Green was capable of. And I mean, he still scored a 90, so you're okay, but he's that inside guy, it looks like. Not really showing a huge ceiling for the year, I'd think, despite getting 128 in round one. He did have 37 possessions to get to that. And it looked like the Giants were cooked this week against the Eagles, which is something I suggested could happen. I tipped the Eagles, but then again, like I tipped the Crows. So I had the theory right, and because I go for the Crows, I guess I just love tipping them every week. Get on the green tea, folks. Basically, Jaden Hunt, I don't really have a structure, so I'm just going to see where this commentary takes me. But Jaden Hunt was as my top scoring defender is. Oh no, he lost a kick, so he isn't anymore. He was on 89. Guess it was McGrath then. Jaden Hunt, as a whole, looking like a good option. I think I might talk more holistically about philosophy for this game, as I think it's an important time to talk about like certain situations that everyone's going to be in this year. In regards to players that might underperform or whatever, so I just, it's gonna be hard to know where to start. I'll just review, let's review my trades first. So Powell, the theory was correct with him not having that midfield attendance that you really need if you're picking him for the, as a mid-pricer. He scored a 60, I think. And again, he had really low CBAs, so it's just, if you still have him, you have to jump off. I mean, Simpkin is out this week, so maybe he gets an uptick, but it's not going to be a, it's only going to be a temporary thing with Powell. It's unfortunate because he's a gun, but he's just not getting that midfield clock you need. And so, yeah, I went early on Zeeble. I talked about everything with Zeeble last week. He just looks like a fantasy-friendly option in that north back line. Just playing kick-to-kick with Harry Sheezel, the absolute unit. I'm so stoked how I picked this guy up in draft really late. It's just, he's killing it. I guess we started with the forwards. Yeah, Darcy Cameron looks... He was electric that first quarter. He dominated. He looks like someone you want to keep all year. It's looking like I'll probably trade Laddams out this week. We'll get to that in a sec. But having this ruck forward status with a guy like this, I did the same thing with English last year. Having that flexibility is just... It's really beneficial just to be able to have so many options you can do in regards to like the mid prices that are breaking out, and just give you such more ability to grab those guys when you can move players around very easily. So Chandler did something basically what you would think he would do, a decent rookie score, but he's just going to absolutely explode in price because of that first week. Decent bench scores, they're just going to grow in price. And, you know, like trading out Fergus Green doesn't look like the smartest option from last week because you don't know how bipolar the scoring are with some of these rookies. Like Fergus Green could have gotten 80 this week. He kicked four behinds, one in each quarter. So basically, if he kicks all those goals, I'm not sure if they were all like marks and kick at goal, but that's like a 30-point swing just because he couldn't kick straight, which he's in the team for, which is a bit concerning. So he could have gotten 80, and then he's just absolutely flying in value. So you never know with these guys. Collins getting that 77 was great for holding Kelly, but yeah, Golden's looking really good still. Taranto doing his thing. Dunkley is an interesting one. It looks like the correct strategy was not starting with him right now. Want to jump on later, but I guess, yeah, in retrospect, maybe having an Oliver in your midfield as opposed to Dunkley there is just... was the right option. And same goes for Doherty, but again, you can't really tell how those things are going to go. Like everything pointed to Dunkley and Doherty just being, you know, like 10 points above the rest of the defenders. But again, something to maybe think about next year if there's similar guys, you know. Maybe just playing that total value game is the way to go these days. Laddams was incredibly disappointing despite having the role. He had low time on ground. From what I saw from stats, it might have been incorrect time on ground stats. But he's going to get towed up against Grundy this week. And scoring a 68 in that total domination by Hawks has really put me off. And I would, if I had more desperate needs to adjust, I might keep him for another week and see how he continues, but he's not making cash anymore. Very similar to Sheed, borderline McPherson. He's just a little cheaper, so I'm looking at trading Sheed and Laddams out, but we'll get to that in a sec. I talked about McKenzie there. Warple struggled early in his game against Sydney, but got to an 82, which is great. Will Setterfield is just carrying my team. He's just, if I am to win a hat this year or a car, the dream, it's going to be on the back of these first 2 weeks from Setterfield. Just everyone's jumping on now. Like when I started the year, I think he was around I can't remember if he was below 1% owned or something like that. But I reckon by the end of this week, he's going to be at like 15 to 20% owned. He's one of the most traded in targets this week, and he's already jumped like, what did he start at, like 602? He's already jumped 100k. Just incredible, an incredible pick. And it's not like you couldn't see him scoring a lot better than he has in his past. For one, his last year in Carlton, his last few games, he was getting 95s, 98s. And that was still like not really on as an inside player, which is what he was basically drafted as. Like, this guy was a number five pick that's being played out of position. He's had an ACL injury early, which in his career, which cooked him a little, but he's never really been played as that inside mid that he is. And to see him smashing it like that is just incredible. Just a goated player right now. And again, I was looking at the people that are leading this Barramundi's guy. He doesn't have Setterfield. Like, incredible. It gives me hope for where my team is at, that a guy that's averaging 126 is not picked by the ranked one guy. And I'm trying to compare my team to also these top guys, their team values, and working out where I can catch up in terms of cash generation or I am ahead in. And they've got cash gen quite well in some of these guys that you think might be keepers, which is good for me because you're not trading them out and like getting that cash as the season progresses. So maybe LDU, you know, he slows down, but he's gained that like 50 or 60K and it doesn't really matter. It's money that you can't really like get. You can't sell and put somewhere else to keep growing, you know? So yeah, just positive things there. Same as Tom Green. Like, I mean, he's one you probably, I think, at some stage you will trade out one of those top guys. But yeah, interesting things. Connor Rozee's looking not so great. He had like 50% CBAs this week. Comes up against the Crows though, which he should smash. But I'm hoping the Crows shut him down because he's a guy capable of taking over against the Crows. He's won the medal in the past. But yeah, he's looking like a decent fade at the moment. We'll see what happens later. Maybe he's an upgrade target, you know. Hayden Young was terrible. So people ahead of me personally that have Young, he's looking like a guy that I thought he would be with that second game. It's just he's too much of a lockdown defender at stages, and it doesn't have the incredible fantasy role to, I think, jump to that next level, which is like he was priced at what, an 80-ish score. And just I didn't personally see him getting to that 95 area. I think I was sort of thinking he would stay around that 85 price, but again, we'll see with these guys. Dacos is looking like a great pick. I was personally just talked out of him. Well, I guess, yeah, I was super confident in him, and then just too much outside noise, I think, changed my opinion into thinking he was a guy that was just so easily going to get shut down with a tag, like especially watching that McGuinness game. I think that's where I made my decision, which is kind of annoying. I think I looked too much into the preseason game with Dacos getting shut down like that. But he's looking like a great pick. Can he keep this 115 average up? Like, he's absolutely flying. I mean, the thing with all these kind of selections is like he's definitely looking like a keeper, but now he's priced at 98, I think. And so if you're looking to trade him in, you have to decide, is he going to average above 98 the whole year for him to be worth it? He's played two great games. So he probably can. He's like that main sort of accumulator in that Collingwood team. It's just probably one I'm looking at later in the year just to see how he's still going now, because I have missed him. I want to be jumping on all the really good value guys to have the cash generation going that's necessary to really, really smash the game, basically. So yeah. McGrath was okay. Still looking at this first pick guy. But yeah, again, just seeing Setterfield not in that guy, the main guy's midfield, gives me a lot of hope. And I'm happy to, again, have improved with Kelly on my bench. So if he's back this week, it's looking really good for me personally. And now Jack McRae. Bont is whatever. He, I respect the game he played. It just wasn't very fantasy friendly, but he got a bit of a Bevo wing, but I'm not too concerned with Bont at this stage. He looks much more capable of avoiding all the Luke Beveridge nonsense that has happened this first two games. But I guess my theory of captaining McRae was totally wrong. It's pretty rough, my first two captain choices here. One getting concussed, and then McRae getting just... He was in the forward pocket for what was almost a quarter, it seemed. And he was just coming to the bench straight after that. It was super, super annoying and just sad to watch. Like, this fantasy gun is getting absolutely shafted by Luke Beveridge. I mean, he gets moved around the ground to positions he's never been in, and he's a premiership winning center midfielder. Like, keep him in there, Luke Beveridge. To think that, firstly, Dunkley being gone, and knowing, like, statistically, with Dunkley out of the side for the Bulldogs, Bontempelli and McRae averaged basically 10 to 15 points more than what they're priced at to start the season, is essentially the main reason why I picked them. And for now, this round two, to captain McRae because Treloar was also out, so I was expecting more midfield time as opposed to like 20% less midfield time for McRae, is just, ugh. Luke Beveridge really lost the plot this game. Just, I don't know what he's thinking, trying to move everyone around like this. Just put him back in the guts, man. Come on. So silly. Now he's talking about being inventive or something this week coming. I mean, what the hell does that mean? Just put him back in the guts. Seriously. Seriously, man. Yeah, to have him captain there, it's just... I guess what I analyzed from the Saints Freo game was wrong. It was mainly the defenders that were boosted scoring. What I should have noticed is that a player like Sarong only got like a 90 or something. I looked at Brayshaw's 112 and thought, yeah, okay, he did well, so I'm going to back in the Dogs. But yeah, avoiding captains against the Saints, unless they're defenders, which McGrath comes up against now, but you can't really vice captain or captain him. So yeah, and now a lot of people are trading McRae. He's one of the most traded out guys, but I just, as a philosophy, I don't want to be trading these guys that I've started with that are like the keeper picks, no matter how their price fluctuates, you know. So could McRae have a worse game that got bevoed? No, I don't think so. And he scrambled to a 73. So it's only damaging your team more. Like, I'm of the opinion you're locking in those losses without looking at the whole picture, which is basically a 1 to 2 month time frame for these guys. Like, what if McRae goes 120, 120, 120 the next 3 weeks, and then you're stuck with a guy that you traded down to, which may be a Setterfield, and Setterfield sort of falls back down to an 80-ish. Like, it's just not the game I play. I'm looking at as much strategy as possible to have leverage over the rest of the comp, which hopefully now Josh Kelly is, for one. He looked really missed in that Giants midfield. So as long as his head's all good from that concussion, I'm really hoping Kelly can pump out some huge scores just the next 5 weeks and, yeah, really get me a jump on people that traded him out and didn't start him. So, yeah, remains to be seen there. A few guys I missed, like Will Day, I'm confident in now. I should have started him over McPherson. I do have a bit of an ego thing with this McPherson pick I did. But again, with McPherson, it's super frustrating. He's had the first game, he had a quarter where he just pigged out like Zeeble, basically, like just grabbing all those marks and plenty of possession, like fantasy-friendly game. And he did that in the first quarter this week. And then just a total drop-off with this Suns team. I think like the Suns game style is just maybe antithetical. Is that a word? I think so. To McPherson getting on the end of a lot of the fantasy scoring. But again, he did it in the first quarter. And most of his kicks were really good. Like, he was one of the guys early in the Suns game that was hitting a target and actually progressing their game to goal opportunities. So I don't see him getting dropped if Jew was watching that game. He looks good in that role he's in. It's just, he got ignored a lot. He's around it. It could have been so much better. It's a hard one to still work out. But again, he's definitely on the chopping block this week against the Cats. If he can't, I guess, get to maybe an 80. Like, he's still got a lowish break even, so he's not going to be losing cash, which is the worst situation you can be in. So yeah, he gets to hold over a guy like Laddams and Sheed, which I'm looking at trading out for Stocker and Day. Yeah, watching Day, despite not having the greatest second half, I mean the Swans just controlled the ball so much that it was hard for any Hawks to get on the end of anything. But Will Day looked really good the first half. He had a giant uptick in midfield time this game. So yeah, he's one I'm confident more in than to start the year. And obviously in hindsight, you would have started him, but I was just skeptical of how real is that midfield time and his involvement with the Hawks. And it looks like, especially it's with the halfback time he also has now, it looks like he can join Sicily in that kick-to-kick game. I just don't want to see him on the wing too much. That's basically it. Liam Stocker as well. He was a guy I mentioned last week. I would really like the look of. He gave a 98 this week, and he looks like one of these guys that sort of just gets on the end of a lot of the first kicks from a kick-in. I think he took a few kick-ins as well. He looks involved. And as a guy that was drafted, highly rated by whoever, the Silvani, as a midfielder, he has the ability to accumulate, you know, as midfielders do. So being in that defensive line, he's playing sort of loose, not too much of a shutdown role. I just really like the sort of game plan that revolves around Stocker, and he's got a super low break even now, so he's a great one to pick up. If he continues what he's doing, you know, coming up against Essendon, it should be an easy matchup. I really like the Stocker pick at the moment. And then the other guy, basically, that I could decide to pick over one of those two guys is Rochelli. Again, he was another one talked about last week. He started off okay, had a really, really big third quarter. He's just so electric. He's such a gun. He's going to be such a great player. And that midfield clock up had a small uptick. So he's getting about a third of the game starting at center bounces. He just looks so much more involved than he was last year. But coming up against a Port going to strangle the Crows, fantasy-wise, maybe. But I'm super keen on him like being the best on ground and winning the medal this week. So yeah, that remains to be seen. I'm going to be kind of annoyed not picking him and him winning like a medal this week. Basically, it's like my heart says pick Rochelle, right? But then my mind is saying pick Stocker and Day. Like, these are the more sensible options. Stocker, lower break even, Will Day, more of a secured midfield and fantasy game, and less risk with him being 20% owned now. So, yeah. We'll go to the guys I'm trading out. Sheed maybe can improve on what he's doing. He's showed it a little bit. The second half of the game against the Giants, Eagles were moving the ball really quickly. They weren't really messing around with it a lot. And so I don't think Sheed's going to be, like, if they just, the Eagles showed they can win playing a fast game instead of just messing around with it. So I think Sheed is limited for that reason in his ability to score. He's not going to get a heap of marks around the game, around the ground, because the ball's just going to progress over him, basically. And he just looks a little washed, to be honest. He just looks like a guy that hasn't played a lot in the past year, which he has. And being priced at this, he's not gaining cash, and you need him to be scoring above what he's priced at. With this 600k price range and taking up a midfield slot, it's just, can't have it. Like, in retrospect, it was the best option to pick Setterfield instead of Sheed, instead of having both of them. But I thought Sheed had more upside than he has shown the past 2 weeks. So, yeah, it's just not enough. He could be good against Freo this week, but again, he might not. So, I'm jumping off Sheed. And Laddams' experiment has failed, folks, in my opinion, to score 68 in that smashing. It looks like he's getting ignored for easy possessions around the ground. And he's not the greatest hit-out merchant. So coming up against Grundy this week, I can see Laddams only barely scraping to like 10 hit-outs, which is just, you can't have that as one of your rucks. And so, yeah, he's really similar to Sheed. He's not generating that cash I need. So trading Laddams out and sending Cameron into the ruck there. That's what the reason I picked Cameron basically is for, having this emergency option if Laddams didn't work out. So I'm pulling the trigger there. And then I'm able to send McPherson to the forward line for now, grab Day and Stocker with Jinby just sitting in the midfield for now. Yeah, those are my trade situations. It's just, for me, it's about getting these guys that, basically for Stocker, you're wanting him to really contest day costs, getting as close to day costs as possible, you know. And then you're sitting happy with say a Stocker getting and maybe getting to a 90 and day costs 100. Like, that's a win for me against the competition, because I'm generating so much more cash for similar points output, which then as we approach the buys, I can trade these guys out into, you know, the huge players of the comp, like a Dawson who might find huge form at the second in the second half of the year. It looks like Dawson, I think, as the year progresses, is going to become more of a midfielder for the Crows, because we desperately need someone like him in the midfield. One of these, like, these clean, confident, big-bodied, classy operators, you know, like those premier guys. I think Dawson's going to become one of those guys for the Crows. He looks like he's going to, as the year progresses, head into the midfield, which will be really needed and important. So yeah, one to watch there. I'm watching Dawson closely. As soon as he gets that midfield role, I reckon he will explode and just be one of the best scorers of the year, to be honest. Yeah, that's probably it for the team. I reckon I've explained a lot of my thought process so far.
So yeah, 2043 score. Again, I'm content with it knowing that I held Kelly this week. And if, the more I think about it, I captain Kelly, I captain McRae, I hold Kelly for a McKenzie on my field. I have a Bytel injury. I honestly reckon this is like this is 100, 150, 200 point sort of loss I've had on decisions that I guess you can't really see coming. It all just feels a little unlucky to me. Like, to think Luke Beveridge, for one, has done what he's did, has done what he has, it's just goofy. And obviously, there were skeptical looks at what, like, there was a little sketchiness with picking McRae or Bont with Bevo, but it's like you can't expect him to do what he did this first week with Dunkley out. Like, it just seemed like a really good play. We'll see what happens as the year progresses with those two, but I mean, if Bevo keeps doing this, he's going to get sacked. Like, he's going to get sacked, and then you want to have the Dogs back in because they'll be in their appropriate positions, you know? Jaden Hunt scoring an 86 was great. He's going to smash his cash generation now. Really good to see that. And I'm really happy I held him for a week just to see what he could do at Optus. Turned out to be the correct decision. Doherty was not great. Hopefully he bounces back. So yeah, these guys that are leading, basically, some of them don't have Dunkley, some of them don't have Doherty, and then they have yeah, they have just those Olivers, those Brayshaws at their M1 and M2, the LDU pick. Can they maintain that huge scoring above the rest of the comp? Maybe. I am just still... LDU looks like breaking out, for one. Kind of a miss. But again, I just want to see 2-3 more weeks to see how these guys are going, because at the end of the year, are you going to want to have LDU in one of these 8 positions? Maybe, maybe not. I don't know. It's looking like one you should have had to start the year. And Oliver having that huge last quarter, it looked like it happened because of that blackout, basically. He just started pumping up his score immensely during that last second half of the last quarter in Brisbane. Again, he's one of these guys that looks like being right up there as the top scorers this year, but yeah. Lacking a captain option so far has hurt me, so I got to be thinking more about my VC and C. It's super important, and really important, I think, now to take, like, a 110, because my captains have been a 91 and a 73, 77, 73. It's just super frustrating to have so much go right, and then those kind of options fall through. But again, it could be worse, you know? Not going to complain too much. As long as I have a good captain this week, then I'll be content. So yeah, 115K in the bank now. I'm hoping I can be a guy that finds an upgrade earlier than most coming into this next few weeks. You know, maybe McKenzie gets like a 50 and it looks like his scoring is drying up. I am keen on, like, fading some of those kind of guys early to get a keeper early if I can find one. So yeah. I doubt I'll do another video this week. I'm just gonna wrap everything up with one here. We'll see you guys next time. That's everything we won't stop yet. We'll look at a few other trade targets. So I've talked about where's the stats center? How do you find players traded out and et cetera? I don't actually know how to do that. We'll look at some of these first ranked teams again. The players here, right? guy like Young, I think he's going to cause Mr. Barramundi's fish shack. It's going to cause his team to start fading if he continues with those 50s, right? So there's two things you want to do with these high-tiered guys, these high-ranked teams. The players that you want to differentiate yourself from with, is that a great sentence? Who knows? Like a Young, I don't want to be picking up Young. I want to be finding an option against him as the season goes on. And the players you want to match up with, because you know they're great scorers and you don't want to have a point of difference there. So like the Olivers, the Brayshaws. Not necessarily LDUs, but he's started well. But like the Callahans here, like I don't like the Callahan pick. He really saved his score this week. It's just that again, he's playing these really big last quarters. Witts is another one. Can he maintain a really good average? I would be looking to have a point of difference against Witts, like a Cameron. Can Cameron outscore Witts for 10 to 15 points for the rest of the year? Maybe. They are sort of similar. Witts is decent, but those are the kind of things I'm looking at. Rosie is a big one. Differentiating myself from the comp with Rosie. So he's 60% owned. And it didn't look good for him on the weekend playing half of his game forward, which is a little bit of a sketchy situation I thought could happen with Horn Francis coming in, basically just having to be one of those guys in the midfield, and then you having like the Drew, the Wines, all these guys both coming back, you know. Then on his bench, he doesn't have the best cash generators. Long looked okay. Ulland, I think, is going to get dropped super early now. 27, not great if you traded him in. McVee's just, he's going to be gone soon. So he doesn't have much of a cash-generating team here. So he's going to struggle as the year goes on trying to upgrade, you know, and people are going to jump ahead of him. So that's what I'm looking at here with these top guys, just to work out who's the best placed to maintain that first ranking, you know, like, going for the car here, guys, as best I can. Another guy I would love to talk about is my boy Chalked FC here. Overall winning our league at the moment. And the man is ranked 66th overall for now. This is his team. I actually want to go to rankings and show him there because that's a bit busted. Chalked FC really putting on the... Oh, he's 65th. You're kidding. Putting on the, what's the word I'm looking for? He's the guy to, square up to in our league right now. Basically, it's looking like picking LDU, Oliver, and Brayshaw with the three big guys in the midfield that are really carrying these top-end guys at the moment with the high overall rankings. Just really good captain options week on in, week on out, you know? Dom not starting Dunkley there has been a galaxy brain play so far. And it remains to be seen whether or not that was the best play coming into the next 2-3 weeks for that. Will Dunkley go a 130 against his old team? If he does, Chalked FC is really going to drop. In regards to the rest of the comp, because he doesn't have him, and so many people do. English and Marshall and the Rucks looking like the set and forget option that was the best play. Does English slow down this week against McInerney, who's a restrictive Ruck? We will see it. I doubt it. English looks like one of the best players this year to pick up. What's he owned by? 38%. Yeah, he's killing it. Holding Bytel is an interesting one. I personally didn't think he would be back this year. So, yeah. Sorry, I just got a phone call. Just ignore that. Bytel is one that I don't think will be back this week. If he is, Chalked FC is laughing. Again, I don't think he will, though. Having Ulan there is going to be a concern. Yeah. Chalked FC in a DT Elite. DT Elite zone. The bar for now. That's it, guys. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next week.